If you would please join me in the call to worship. Honor.
Honor and praise.
Honor, praise, and glory.
Honor, praise, and glory are yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
In celebration, we join the crowds of old.
Waving branches, giving honor to the Messiah.
Yet, our celebration is bittersweet, for our story doesn't end here.
We know the pain of what lies ahead.
Today anticipates the rest of the story.
A story of betrayal and death, a story of hope and resurrection.
To you who triumphed over death, we sing our praise. Your steadfast love endures forever. As we face your death and recall the week of your suffering, may we do so with the joy that anticipates the celebration of your resurrection. May we do so with the confidence to turn to you in both life and death. Amen.
Our prayer of confession. Okay, I think that's on. Would you pray with me? Lord Jesus, we are a fickle people, quick to turn away. We are quick to flock to you when all is well, but we are prone to scatter when there is opposition or criticism. Too often we have kept silent before you, afraid to proclaim your praise. It is easy to join the crowd as you ride triumphantly into Jerusalem, singing our joys and expectations, dancing our hopes and dreams. It is far more difficult to stand by you as the crowd cries for your crucifixion. Forgive our weakness when we turn away. Strengthen us for the journey ahead as we relieve your suffering and death, that we might stay beside you to the end. Give us the courage to shout our hosannas, not only today, but each and every day. Amen. Take a moment of silent prayer to bring your concerns and your confessions to God. The Lord is our strength and might. Jesus is our salvation. In Jesus our sins are forgiven, and in Jesus our cries are answered. Our salvation is at hand. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Testament scripture reading today is from Isaiah 50, verses 4 through 9. The sovereign Lord has given me a well-instructed tongue to know the world that sustains the weary. He wakens me morning by morning, wakens my ear to listen like one being instructed. The sovereign Lord has opened my ears. I have not been rebellious. I have not turned away. I offered my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who pull out my beard. I do not hide my face from mocking and spitting, because the sovereign Lord helps me. I will not be disgraced. Therefore, have I set my face like flint, and I know I will not be put to shame. He who then will bring charges against me? Let us face each other. Who is my accuser? Let him confront me. Is it the sovereign Lord who helps me? Who will condemn me? They will all wear out like a garment. The moths will eat them up. Herein ends the scripture reading. May the Lord help us with understanding and appreciating his holy word.
Blessed is he who comes.
scripture today comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 19, reading verses 28 through 40. And I will tell you that this scripture is also connected to Psalm 118, verse 26. And you'll see what I mean. Here begins the reading. After Jesus had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. As he approached Bethpage and Bethany, at the hill called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you why you are untying it, say, 'The Lord needs it.'" The Lord needs it. Those who were sent ahead went and found it just as he had told them. And they were untying the colt, and its owner asked them, "Why are you untying the colt?" And they replied, "The Lord needs it." They brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. And he went along, and people spread their cloaks on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down to the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in a loud voice for all the miracles they had seen. "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, rebuke your disciples." And ultimately he was saying, "Tell them to be quiet." Here ends the reading of God's word. You know, in Psalm 118, it is called a Hallel Psalm. It is also called an Egyptian Hallel. And the Hallel Psalms in the book of Psalms are usually from Psalm 113 to around 118. And these Psalms from 113 to 118 are used during the celebration of Passover. And you will see that in a lot of Jewish temples and their celebration during the time of Passover. And the final psalm, which we just praised with our palms, "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord." That is a psalm that they sang as they entered into the city of Jerusalem and into the temple, where they were there to worship God. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord will bless you. You know, originally this Psalm 118 was written for three different events in history. And the first place that it talks about, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," is depicting the Israelites as they escape Egypt. Their exodus out of Egypt and their journey as they went for many, 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 many years through the wilderness and finally ended up at Mount Zion, which is called Jerusalem. You know, the second time that it is mentioned and praising and triumphing the Lord is when Christ rides on the donkey into the city of Jerusalem. This is where this text is fulfilled again. And you know, this story about the donkey and also about this phrase also comes in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So it has great importance in it to have been repeated that many times in that many writings of the disciples. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, for the Lord is God. And he has made his light to shine on us. 118, verse 27. And you know, the third time that it takes this psalm and it brings it to light is in the forecast, in the awaiting of the Messiah to come. Not only the Exodus for the Israeli people or the Hebrew people, then also the triumphal entry into the city of Jerusalem, but also in acknowledging now that the Lord, who they're talking about, the Lord is God. This is a new identification, a revealing of who Jesus really was. And we all know that the Hebrew people were waiting for a king or a Messiah to come. They all through their history, the Old Testament, that is what they are looking for. They are looking for a king, the Messiah to come. And in this text, it says, the Lord who you have just spoken of is God. Combining those two thoughts, Yahweh, God with Jesus. Wow. What an awakening moment for the Jewish, the Hebrew people. Wow. But you know, this is also a difficult moment, even though it certainly is a turning moment for Christ in his life and his ministry and his journey. Do you remember a few weeks ago, I talked about Jesus lamenting over Jerusalem, and I spoke of it like a hen who wants to take in all her little chicks underneath her wings and close them in and protect them, and wanting the very, very best for her chicks. And I also talked about how Jesus wept over Jerusalem because he knew when he rode in on the donkey and he came in as King, as Yahweh, as Lord, that some would accept him and others would not. This was a scripture that was fulfilling prophecy. Jesus coming in the name of the Lord. Wow. You know, there are several times in Scripture that Jesus used something, a possession of someone, to glorify God for the purpose of that. We see that in this story where a donkey is taken and used to carry the new king, the Christ, the Messiah, into Jerusalem. But in Luke 3, we also see where Simon gives his boat to Jesus, and Jesus takes his boat and he goes along the lake and he preaches to hundreds and thousands of people. A simple boat, a possession, but Jesus took it and used it to bring glory and honor to his Father. And in John 6, we see a little boy who has 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. And he takes this little boy's lunch and he brings it and he blesses it and he breaks it and it multiplies in order to feed 5,000 people. Whoever thought their lunch would do that? This young boy never imagined that Jesus would take something of his and use it and bless it and expand it and do a miracle where it would feed that many people. And while they sat there eating their lunch, Jesus was able to teach them about the gospel and about the love of God. Wow. And here in this story, a donkey is used to carry the king. A small possession, but a triumphal entry, and one we will not forget. You know, I don't know that Simon, when he gave Jesus his boat, ever thought it would be used to preach the gospel, that Jesus would use it to minister to those that were in need and heal the lame and the sick and the blind and cast out devils and provide food for the hungry. Little did he know his gift, his possession, would be used in that extent. And a young boy bringing his lunch, thinking he was going to sit on the hillside and just listen to this wonderful teacher. His lunch becomes food and nourishment and also a method, a miracle to show the people of God's love. Wow. These small things, these small possessions, fulfilled prophecy in some way. You know, have you ever been in a situation where you really needed some help? Oh, I have many. And you know, it may be a situation that got out of hand, and now you realize it's just too difficult for you to handle or to do anything about. And you think, I don't know what to do, God. I don't know how to get through this or how for things to change. But is there someone, is there something, somehow, that you can come and transform this situation and change the direction in which I am going? Sometimes I don't think we realize what we have the ability to do. I don't think Simon realized it. I don't think the boy with his little lunch knew it. I don't think the man that owned the donkey understood what these things were going to be used for. But Jesus took those things and used them to bring glory to his Father. You know, about, oh, many, many years ago, I can remember my mother telling me a story about a time in their ministry where my dad was a pastor and he earned about $5 a week in his church. And he lived, we pioneered a church on Cape Cod, Massachusetts. No more expensive place to live than Cape Cod in New York City, I'll tell you right now. So $5 didn't go very far. Well, it got to the point where my mom went up into the cupboard and she pulled down two potatoes. That's all that was left in the cupboard. There was no milk, no bread, no meat, just two potatoes. My mother cut them up and put them in a boiling pot of water. And she began to hum and sing as she prepared the meal for five people in our family. And she began to thank God and say, God, thank you for these two potatoes that you have given me and that we are about to eat. She blessed them, but then she put a P.S. on the end of her prayer. And she said, God, just in case you don't know, we don't have any food for tomorrow. She went on preparing the potatoes, and she drained them and took them out of the pan and put them in a bowl. And she sprinkled a little bit of salt on them. And we all set the table as we That was our job to do, set the table and get the forks and spoons all in order. And I remember there was a knock on the door, and I was very, very small. But I remember as she opened the door, there was a lady standing there with two bags of groceries. And I remember my mom looking at her and saying, "Thank you so much. You have answered my prayer." And the lady said, "Well, while I was meditating and praying this morning, I asked God if there was anything today that I could do to help meet someone else's need. Anything. And your name came to mind." And she said, "When I thought of you and I prayed about you," she said, "I got this image that you needed food. So I went to the store and I bought two bags of groceries. I'm not sure they're exactly what you would eat or your family, but it's the basics, milk and bread and meat and vegetables and fruit, whatever, and I hope this will help you." My mother thanked her. She closed the door and she put the bags on the counter and she took out a few things and began to cook some things and prepare some things to add to the two potatoes on the table. I remember looking at my mom and there was a tear running down her face. She never said another word, and we all sat around and ate our dinner. I often think sometimes how God uses the simple, the mundane, the ordinary, the possessions that we have for God's glory. He used a donkey, he used bread and fish, he used a boat. And maybe he can use what we have as well. You know, God can take the little, the small, and use it for the greater good. But it really all depends on us, how willing we are to be those vessels that will be used by God to bring glory and honor to Him. As we are in this Lenten period, and as we're looking into ourselves and for our own reflection, it is here and it is now and in this time that we too can ask God how we can be used for His glory. What does the Lord need of us today? What does He need of you? C.T. Studd once said this, and I think he says it well. "There is only one life that will soon be passed, and it is only what is done for Christ that will last." Amen. As we go to the Lord in prayer today, I know there are many concerns on your heart. And I hope that you will open your own heart and your mind and your being to God to allow Him to use what you have for His honor and His glory. I know there are prayers listed in the bulletin today, and there are many on your heart. There are many in our city, in our country, and in the world that need the hand of God to bring deliverance and healing and hope into their lives. Let us pray. God, we come to you with open hearts and minds. What a joy it is to celebrate Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem. As the disciples gathered a colt for him to ride on, and the people around him shouted, "Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And they laid coats and cloaks and material and flowers on the roadway as he rode into the holy city. Jesus, we want you to ride into places of our own life, where there is tension and anger in our lives, may you bring peace. Where there are places that need to be healed and hurts that need to be filled and salve to be put on them, may you do that today. We need to shout with joy and shout the ringing in our own hearts that you have brought us hope and eternal life. We bring to you those needs that we have in our hearts and our minds, knowing that you were wounded to bring healing to each of them. And we also pray the prayer that you taught your disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Blessing today. Let us wave and praise to God. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Do it to the person next to you. Blessed is he who comes to the name of the Lord. And the other side. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Amen. Go in peace.
The King of glory comes, the nation rejoices. Open the gates before him, lift up your voices. He gave his life for us, the pledge of salvation.
get up!